Welcome to the Veritas Forum, engaging university students and faculty in discussions about life's hardest questions and the relevance of Jesus Christ to all of life.
Thank you. The theme for tonight is, why hasn't religion died out? In the secular university today, it is often taken for granted that religion is irrelevant to the intellectual project, and that as time goes by, and more of the world becomes educated and modern, fewer people will take religious belief seriously. Religion is a cultural artifact which informs the clothes we wear and the kind of food we eat, but it has little to do with questions of fundamental truth. New atheist public intellectuals like Richard Dawkins see belief in God as delusion, and the Enlightenment Project as the beginning of a great awakening as the human race goes beyond its diluted religious roots. From this perspective, religious believers are on the wrong side of history. But how does this meta-narrative square with empirical evidence? Is the world becoming more secular as it becomes more modern? Or has secularization, ironically, turned out to be the delusion? I'm privileged to introduce two world-class public intellectuals to lead our conversation tonight. Peter Berger is Professor Emeritus of Religion, Sociology, and Theology at Boston University and is widely regarded as one of the greatest living sociologists of religion. With over 75 published books, Peter Berger has revolutionized the field of sociology. His most recent publication, The Many Altars of Modernity, Toward a Paradigm for Religion in a Pluralist Age, draws on decades of research and reflects on the relationship between modernity and religion. It explores the implications of the growing realization that secularization theory, or the widely held belief that global modernization would lead to a decline in religion, is in fact empirically untenable. In its place, Peter Berger offers a new paradigm through which to understand religion in the modern age. Ross Douthat is a New York Times columnist and author of Bad Religion, How We Became a Nation of Heretics, which the Washington Post calls a superb documentation of America's crisis of faith. Among his other publications are Grand New Party and Privilege, Harvard, and the Education of the Ruling Class. He is the youngest regular op-ed writer in the history of the New York Times, having been invited at the young age of 29 to fill the position. Ross has been described as its most consistently thoughtful and level-headed opinion columnist. So please join me in welcoming Peter Berger and Ross Douthat. We will begin the evening with opening remarks from Peter Berger.
Good evening. What I propose to do this evening is to introduce to you what, well, Kristen used the term paradigm, which sounds like a megalomaniac term. It simply means a way of looking at things. And over the last few years, no single individual can do that. Over the last few years, I, together with some colleagues, both in this country and in Europe, have been working on a new way of looking at the relationship of religion and modernity. Maybe totally false, but I think it's interesting, and I happen to think it's empirically valid. I don't have very much time to do this. This is a very Japanese-oriented evening. Every 5 minutes seemed to be programmed. And I told Ms. Kim, that I would ignore the limit, the time limits, if I have to. But I'll try to keep roughly, being a polite person, roughly within the time limit I was given. But let me put it this way. Einstein succeeded in putting his theory in one mathematical formula. I can't do that. Luther needed 95 theses to start the Reformation. By the way, the anniversary, 500th anniversary of the nailing of the 95,000 theses on the castle door of Wittenberg comes next year. By the way, there was no castle door, but let's not go into this. It's a nice image, nailing these. It happened to be the university bulletin board, and he was really putting down what he wanted to do in the following semester. He didn't know what the effect would be. Well, I'm not going to put 95 theses before you that keep you here way beyond your bedtime. What I will do is I will try to sum up what I have to say on this topic in six theses. Four of them are social scientific theses and basically are the result of our work on what we still call a new paradigm, although I assure you this is not meant in some megalomaniac sense. Since this is a Christian organization that is sponsoring this, I don't know if Memorial Church, or for that matter the Harvard Divinity School, still considers itself Christian, but since these are the auspices, my last two theses have to do with what I think, from a Christian point of view, one can say about the empirical picture that the first four theses paint. Okay, I think that's enough by way of introduction. Thesis number one, and that is where I'm afraid I run right up against what some of you probably think. The thesis is very simple, but has far-reaching implications. Contrary to what many people think, we don't live in a secular age. We live in a pluralist age, which is a very different story. The distinguished Canadian philosopher Charles Taylor wrote a book with the title The Secular Age a few years ago. It's the biggest book I've ever tried to read. It's over 800 pages. And some of it is quite interesting. He's a very competent philosopher, but already the title of the book is wrong. We don't live in a secular age. Most of the world is more religious than it ever was. The exceptions, really, not the United States. The United States is still a very religious country. It may not seem that way from perspective of Harvard Yard, but most of the country is very religious still, despite what some misleading survey data have told you recently. You have to look at who these nuns are, with no religious affiliation, what they really are. They're not militant atheists at all. The exception to the statement that the world is very religious, there's a geographical exception, which is basically Europe, with some outliers like Australia, New Zealand, perhaps. And there is an international intelligentsia, which is secular. But most of the world isn't secular at all. But it's pluralist, and that makes an enormous difference. I now use the term two pluralisms. I will explain the second term in a moment. But the first meaning of pluralism is what in everyday language one calls pluralism. Many different religions operating more or less at peace within the same society. If they exist in the same society and kill each other or never talk to each other, that's not pluralism. But in much of the world today, this coexistence is relatively peaceful and people talk to each other. That's the basic pluralism, the plurality of religions. Then there is something where the old secularization theory, the people who believed the more modern, the more secular the world will be, were not completely wrong. There is a secular space. And that's the other pluralism, is the interaction between religious discourses and the discourse, the secular discourse, without which a society, a modern society, could not exist. Now, the religious pluralism is obvious. Hare Krishnas are chanting and dancing in front of medieval cathedrals in Europe. I was once disturbed a few years ago. I was having lunch with the Archbishop of Vienna. And we didn't know this noise came overlooking the cathedral. It was Hare Krishnas dancing. South Korean businessmen, who are also Protestant missionaries, smuggled Bibles into China and Central Asia. There are now about 16 million Muslims within the European Union. They are growing by several thousand as we talk. the estimate now is there are about 100 million Christians in China, which is slightly more than members of the Communist Party, and so on and so forth. And the United States, for historical reasons which are not difficult to explain, has been in the vanguard of religious pluralism. And that has been sanctified, as it were, by the American Constitution. And the combination of pluralism, which is a fact, and religious freedom, which is a legal value, is dynamic. And the United States expresses that dynamism very vividly, and I would say, on the whole, rather successfully. Now, I'm still speaking as a sociologist. I'm not saying whether this is good or bad. I'm speaking, as it were, from behind the antiseptic mask of social scientific objectivity. But there are enormous consequences of pluralism. I'm talking about the first pluralism, in terms of individual faith, in terms of religious institutions, and in terms of the state, finally. In terms of individual faith, pluralism does is it undermines the taken-for-grantedness of any religious tradition. Because there are all these other people with whom you constantly rub shoulders who don't believe and don't practice what you believe for very basic psychological reasons that will influence you. And one thing it does, you can no longer take for granted where you happen to be born in terms of religion. Secondly, it changes the nature of religious institutions. Whether they like it or not, and some of them don't like it at all, they become voluntary associations. It changes the relationship between clergy and lay people. The laity gains power, they become consumers. The clergy can't use the police to fill the pews, they have to persuade people to come in and to stay in. And it changes the nature of the state, because all this plurality has to be managed politically if it isn't to explode. So the enormous consequences to pluralism, not secularity, not secularism, but pluralism, which is creating these big changes. Now, in terms of taken for grantedness, I read somewhere that in ancient Greece, when two strangers met somewhere, they asked each other, "What are your gods?" The contemporary equivalent would be to ask your zip code or your area code. If you could answer who your gods were, you would know where the person came from. That is no longer the case. Okay, I don't have to expand on this. But it's not only individuals that change, it's religious institutions that change, that become voluntary and that are in competition with other institutions of the same kind. Richard Niebuhr, the American church historian, said the peculiar American contribution to sociology of religion, concepts of religion, is the denomination, which he defined as a church which recognizes de facto or de jure the right of other churches to exist. And ecumenism is the polite expression of this new relationship. I will not go on taking for grantedness, although I could talk way beyond my allotted time to just talk about that first thesis. What does it mean that religion is no longer taken for granted? Any religion, any religious tradition. Fundamentalism, by the way, can be explained as a project to revoke that loss of taking for grantedness, to restore either an old or a new unanimity on worldviews. It's very difficult to do. And you have to set up a totalitarian society that controls all communications. And the good news of the 20th century, not many good news from the 20th century, is that's very difficult to do. Unless you want to completely isolate yourself from the world economy and world communications. Voluntary association. I said whether you like it or not. The most interesting and, I think, instructive example of a religious institution, in this case a church, Christian church, that has very successfully related to the loss of taken for granted, this is the Roman Catholic Church. Almost exactly 100 years between the First and Second Vatican Council. The First Vatican Council was called by Pius IX, author of the Syllabus of Errors. He had some 80 errors that the Pope must never accept. And then the basic idea was the Roman Catholic Church has the truth. The truth has the right to proclaim itself publicly, but error in principle has no rights. It may be permitted out of necessity or out of good-heartedness, but error has no rights. The truth has rights, and we have the truth. Vatican II, as you know, I think, I would say it's most, at least for non-Catholics, most remarkable contribution is the Declaration on Religious Freedom, which defined religious freedom as a fundamental human right, not for Catholics, but for all religious people and for those who have no religion. It's an enormous change, and the Roman Catholic Church has never been the same since then. And that process of accommodation to pluralism and to religious freedom is still going on very powerfully. First thesis, not secularism, not secularity, but pluralism. Secondly, pluralism undermines taken for grantedness of any religious tradition. Third thesis, churches become voluntary associations. All religious groups become voluntary associations, especially in America. Take Judaism. Judaism, after all, has been the religion of a people. Say in Eastern Europe, when you had these little Jewish communities in Russia and elsewhere, to be a Jew was a destiny. It's not a destiny anymore, certainly not in America. It's a choice. And how you count it, there are at least four and maybe more Jewish denominations. If you count the different Hasidic sects, there are even more. And there's an American Jewish joke which expresses this perfectly. An American Jew is stranded on a desert island all by himself, and he builds two synagogues, one in which he prays and the other in which he never wants to be seen or caught dead in. That's denominationalism. And that's increasing all over the world, not because of American influence, but because similar conditions appear all over the world. That was number three. Number four, let me say a couple things about the secular space. When I started out as a sociologist of religion, which as some of you know was the age, the year of Lincoln's second inaugural, believed in secularization theory because everyone else did. It wasn't crazy. There were some good reasons for it. Its basic proposition was very simple. The more modern, the less religious. Okay? It took me about 25 years to conclude that this was a mistake. It was empirically untenable because of what I said in my first thesis. The world is not becoming ever more secular. The world is becoming, or not becoming, remains strongly religious. But where secularization theory wasn't completely wrong, and where, by the way, Taylor's book is still quite interesting to read, even if you don't accept the implication of the title, every modern society needs a secular space. The basic reason for this is science and technology. You cannot have a modern society without at least the minimum of technology. My favorite method of thinking is free association. And I mentioned Judaism. Let me mention a Jewish example that comes to mind that landed in my notes. I know a very successful Jewish surgeon in Boston. He's a practicing Orthodox Jew, I guess modern Jewish in terms of the Jewish denominationalism. In fact, he wears a yarmulke in his office. He's a very, very nice man. His patients love him. He's very warm. He's a mensch, as they say in Yiddish. And I think it has something to do with his religion. He regards his vocation, I don't know him very well, but his vocation as a mandate for every pious Jew to help in the repair of the universe, which has many flaws, and human beings can help correct those flaws. But when he enters the operating room, you couldn't tell whether he wears a yarmulke because he has this cap on, and everything he does must be by strictly secular discourse. And his being a practicing Jew is irrelevant. If he has a problem in the course of the surgery, he cannot consult the Talmud. He has to operate exactly as if he were a Buddhist or a Presbyterian or an atheist or whatever. Secular discourse. It's not only, well, the hospital is a temple of modernity, but let's not go into this. We recently had a fascinating conference on that at BU. But it's constantly infiltrated by religion. Hospital chaplains, visiting clergy and relatives, patients who pray, nurses who have prayer circles, medical faculties who are interested in alternative healing methods, which usually are either from India or from China. It's not isolated from religion. It interacts with religion. And I think this is very important to understand. I recently came on the writings of a famous Dutch jurist of the 17th century, Hugo Grotius, one of the founders of modern international law. And he wrote that his new discipline was to be handled as if God did not exist. Now, that was not a statement of philosophical atheism. It was a methodological statement. Grotius himself was a pious Protestant. He was an Arminian, which I would call the more humane version of the Dutch Reformation. And he was kicked out of the newly independent Netherlands by the Calvinists who were then in charge. But international law was not going to be based on his religion. It couldn't be. By the time he wrote, European states, some defined themselves as Catholic, some as Protestant, Anglican, Lutheran, Calvinist. Then you had Orthodox Russia, and you had the Ottoman Empire. A international law that would be applicable to all of them would have to be religiously neutral. Couldn't be any particular religion. But it expanded into other areas of life, certainly expanded in domestic law. An American judge who operates under state law or under federal law has, whatever his religion or lack of religion may be, he cannot apply it to the case which he's supposed to judge. He has to bracket his religion. He operates in secular space. That secular space also has to be managed. And what has to be managed is the dividing lines between religious spaces and the secular space. And in the United States today, there are constant litigation. Well, America is the most litigational society on earth. People constantly sue each other. It's a national pastime. I'm still looking for somebody plausible to sue. I haven't found one. Deep pockets, probably. So the secular space is very important, and it in itself, it can become a foundation of religious freedom, because religious freedom is a prerogative. It's a very efficient way of handling both pluralisms. Let me then say again something that goes against what many people think. Religion and secularity, for most people who are religious, is not a question of either or. It's a question of both and. And you don't have to travel very far from where we are now to experience this every day. For the last few years, I periodically taught at the Baptist University in Texas. And there you meet people who are intensely religious, but are as modern as you can get. Petroleum engineers, brain surgeons, you name it. It's not either or, it's both and. Sometimes there are tensions, sometimes there are not. According to my allotted time, I have about 5 minutes left. I think I probably can do it in 5 minutes. And now I will take off my surgical mask and put on my theological hat. I usually describe myself as incurably Lutheran, but it's not a It's not the Lutheranism of the Missouri Synod. It's a very open-minded and undogmatic Lutheranism, which is not my job to explain to you tonight. One thing I want to emphasize, my change of mind about secularization theory had nothing to do with my own personal faith. It had to do with how I read empirical evidence. And I was not the only one. Most sociologists of religion have come to the same conclusion. There are some who hold out, and I admire them. I admire people who don't follow the herd, wherever the herd is going. But they're a very small minority now. Okay, two more theses I promised you, and they are not sociological, they are theological theses. And they're Christian theological theses. Although other religions may very well put their own spin on them. Let me put in a commercial here. My own take on what this whole means, I put in a book called The Many Altars of Modernity, published in the US and in Germany simultaneously in English last year. The Many Altars of Modernity. I have, over the years, lots of experience, acquired a deep respect for African culture, its wisdom and its wit. So I will quote here my favorite Zulu proverb, which says, if I don't beat my own drum, who will? So I mentioned my book, which is readily available. Okay, two more theses, which are not sociological, but theological. Both say the same thing. Pluralism is good for you if you're a person of faith. Don't be afraid of it. Why is it good for you? Well, one thing is because it puts us right into the position of the early Christians. The world into which Paul carried the gospel, an obscure Jewish sect in Palestine, was highly pluralistic, especially in its cities. Just think of Apostle Paul's famous sermon in Athens, where he talked about the many altars in Athens. Why should we deplore the situation which saw the beginnings of the Christian religion? I think the situation allows us a new understanding of faith. Faith is not knowledge. Preachers often present the antithesis faith and lack of faith, and lack of faith is some kind of sin. I think it's very misleading. The opposite of faith is not lack of faith, it's knowledge. I think I know that I'm right now in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and not in Vienna, where I come from, or Washington, where I was last week. I know this, although a philosophy student may try to explain to me that, how do I really know this? Maybe I'm just imagining this, I'm dreaming. You don't exist, you're a dream. I do know it, I'm sure I know it. Religion, faith is not knowledge. Faith is a trust in something that I don't know. And that has very interesting implications. It was very much the reason why the Reformation had the basic notion of we are saved by faith alone. Let me not go into this, not the context, we don't live in the 16th century, but I think that faith alone has a very important meaning for us today. If we are honest, most of us are agnostics. We don't know, we believe. It's not the same thing. And that means that faith always has around it a penumbra of doubt. And I think that's very good. It means that one can be free, not bound by tradition. One can be free and have trust in, well, in a Christian case, in what Jesus Christ tells us about the nature of God. And finally, my last thesis, I don't have 2 minutes, but I'll take maybe four. I'm a very cooperative person. Why is it good for you, faith, pluralism? Because it forces you to distinguish between what is the core of your faith and what is marginal. when you are not completely sure of your faith, you begin negotiating with those who don't share it. What is non-negotiable, what is negotiable, and what isn't. That was a very real problem in the 19th century when modern biblical scholarship invaded Protestant theological faculties, first mainly in Germany and then all over the world. And it was impossible to hold onto the Bible the way most people still did, as a kind of absolutely certain document about truth. It became debatable what was marginal and what was core. The great rabbi Hillel the Elder, who was one of the first big thinkers of rabbinical Judaism, once was asked, I think in mockery, could you explain the meaning of Torah while you stand on one leg? And he then uttered what we, as we know, is the first statement of the Golden Rule. In his version, don't do unto others what you hate if it's done to you. I don't know if that was a good choice. But what could you say about Christianity standing on one leg? By the way, Hillel, I think, shouldn't have chosen the Golden Rule. He should have chosen the Shema, the basic Jewish confession of faith. Our God, the Lord is our God, and the Lord is one. A Muslim would have no trouble standing on one leg and pronouncing the Shahada. There's no God but God, and Muhammad is his prophet, his messenger. A Buddhist would have a little difficulty. He may have to do more than put the second leg down for a couple minutes. He could do it in 5 minutes. The Four Noble Truths and the Eightfold Path. What could a Christian say? And I would say And that was very much part of the negotiations in the 19th century and since then with modern biblical scholarship. I think the core proposition of the Christian gospel is Christ is risen. That is non-negotiable. Now, Hillel added, I should have said this before, after he pronounced, he stood on one leg, he put the other leg down and said, wonderful sentence, the rest is commentary. There are lots of questions about it. The rest is commentary. Well, there are lots of commentary we have to engage in terms of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus Christ to begin with? Why is this resurrection important? Was there an empty tomb? If there had been a police camera in the tomb, what would they have shown on Easter morning? Why is this important for us? What does it signify for the whole cosmos? I think there's nothing more glorious in celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ than the Eastern Orthodox liturgy. The Eastern liturgy is an incredible climax of faith. A wonderful phrase, the risen Christ trampled death with death to bring life to those who are in the tomb. Christ is risen. I think that is non-negotiable, that is central. And Paul was quite right. He wrote in, was it 1st or 2nd Corinthians, I forget, if Christ is not risen, our faith is in vain. What about all the other miracles in the New Testament? Did Jesus walk on the Lake of Galilee? I have no idea. If he was what he said he was, or what I think he was, he could have. But if he didn't, if that somehow got into the Gospels, certainly I wouldn't feel that my faith is vain. It's negotiable. It may be, it may not be. The basic fact, the basic affirmation of resurrection is not. And with this, I will end with a story. Take me less than a minute. I should have been in Japan, accustomed to such time frames. It's a story from the old Soviet Union, where occasionally the not much lamented Soviet Union, except by Mr. Putin, the party occasionally ran atheism campaigns, preaching the important truth of scientific atheism. And the story is that on one of those campaigns, a official of the party went to some village somewhere in Russia. All the villagers had to be assembled and to listen to a one-hour lecture on scientific atheism and on the pernicious and foolish illusions of religion. And when he was finished, he said, we believe in free speech here. The hell they did, but that's what he said. The Orthodox priest, who was also had to be there, has 5 minutes to reply. The story is the priest went up in front, turned toward the assembled villagers, and said, well, he said to the commissar, I don't need 5 minutes. He turned to the assembled villagers and said, Christ has risen. And they replied with the proper liturgical formula, he is risen indeed. Madam Chairman.
Thank you,
I
Peter.
I did not utter the, you know the joke about the three American lies? I will not tell you the first and second, some of you probably know it. The third line is, Madam Chairman, I'll be brief.
Okay. Peter, thank you for those insightful remarks. Now we're going to hear from Ross Douthat. If you think of questions, please text them to the number listed on your program. And we'll be selecting the best and the most common questions for the Q&A. Ross, in reflecting on Peter's comments that the world today is as religious as it ever was, and in some places more so, you made the bold assertion that if you don't try to understand religion, you're not going to understand the 21st century, period. Can you unpack that from your perspective as a journalist?
Sure. I didn't catch what you said. You don't have to do what?
If you don't understand religion, you're not going to understand the 21st century.
Okay. Sure. I mean, I'm not sure that, first of all, thank you all so much for being here. And we were introduced as both distinguished public intellectuals, but really I'm just a journalist, and it's an incredible honor to share the stage with someone as distinguished as Professor Berger. So I'm very grateful for the opportunity. And I'm not sure that I'm going to be able to improve on sort of his initial framework and critique of secularization theory and all of his points about the fact that in many ways, in many places, the world is more religious than ever. And on that level alone, I think the comment I made about needing to understand religion to understand the world should be totally uncontroversial. But I suppose I can just pick out a few examples from the world of journalism, right, where, you know, journalism is, it postures and pretends to represent the first draft of history, but really it's more like a first draft of a first draft of a first draft. It's incredibly immediate and in the now, and so on. But even living in that sort of immediate in the now realm, if you just sort of leap from headline to headline around the world today, if you don't understand religion, you don't understand what's happening in the world right now. And I could list many different examples. I think Peter's point about Christianity's growth in China, for instance, is an incredibly interesting, somewhat understudied, in part because China is still somewhat opaque to us, phenomenon that as China goes through a period of potentially of political upheaval or not upheaval, depending on what happens with the ongoing reforms or not reforms and so on, the religious changes sort of are part of the substructure, basically, of whatever is going to happen in China over the next 40 or 50 years. And I think Western observers may end up very surprised by the role that religion ends up playing in that country. So that's sort of a long-term example, but just to stick to the short-term, you know, we basically have a world order in the West that is being disrupted right now across multiple fronts by conflicts and trends and patterns that are all intimately connected to religion. And you can sort of draw a kind of triangle with one point in Moscow and another point in Germany and another point somewhere in the Middle East. It'll be a slightly misshapen triangle, I guess, right? not misshapen, but not an equilateral triangle, and move from point to point just looking at everything from, you know, obviously the phenomenon of ISIS, the Islamic State at the heart of the Middle East, to the sort of connected to that, this ongoing sectarian conflicts in Syria that in turn are spilling over into Western Europe with mass migration patterns, the likes of which we haven't seen in a long time, that are inevitably connected and leading to divisions that are rooted deeply in the differences between Christian and Islamic civilization, and that even in allegedly secular Europe, those differences are felt, I think, very powerfully, and are sort of felt very powerfully in. It's interesting. You can sort of dig. You can see what's happening in Europe and sort of the political tension between the European leadership class and the actual European public as kind of an example of how Peter's secular intelligentsia, his secular leadership class, doesn't necessarily understand the world that it's trying to govern, and doesn't understand that world in ways that may be destructive to its ability to govern it. And the reality of sort of the secular leadership in Europe right now and its inability to handle mass migration is that it is empowering political parties and political movements in Europe, some of which are on the far left and are sort of notionally secular in that sense, but many of which are on the far right and see themselves as sort of reviving Europe's Christian character. So you have that kind of tangle. I'm not sort of coming to a fine point here. I'm just trying to sort of sketch out the tangle. And then connected to that tangle, you have the sudden attempted reemergence of Mr. Putin's Russia, which is, of course, a form of muscle flexing and power politics and so on that is, in that sense, secular. But it is also connected on multiple fronts to differences between Western Christendom and Orthodox Russian civilization. Putin has moved, in some ways, very skillfully to use a sort of partial revival of religion in the former Soviet Union to cement his hold on power. The Russian sort of movements towards the Near East and are connected to Russia's traditional vision of itself as a protector of fellow Christians against the Ottoman Turk originally. Putin's posture and rhetoric around ISIS is an extension of that kind of rhetoric and so on. And, in all of these cases, you can try and sort of abstract the religious element away, and you can say, well, Putin's just motivated by power in this sense, and the young men of ISIS just want to rape and pillage and do terrible things, and the migrants going to Europe are in search of a better life, and the people who are not necessarily being welcoming to the migrants aren't themselves, the most devout of Christians and so on. And, all of that's true, but it's still also true that there is a bright religious thread running through all of these stories, and these stories would be very different absent the religious element. The fact of ISIS's presence in the Middle East is connected to chaos, violence, civil war, and so on. But the nature of ISIS is defined by a particular interpretation of Islam, right? I mean, you could imagine a different version of ISIS that was barbaric and had some other organizing theory or no theory at all, but the reality is to understand what the specific things ISIS is doing, it helps to understand why they think they are restoring a imaginary, but in their minds, purified form of Islam and so on. So that's, that would just be the sort of foreign affairs headline version of the case for the point I was making. But then, beyond that, I think it's simply the case that if you step anywhere outside the richest, most developed parts of the world, you will find intense religious growth. Latin America, it's Pentecostal and evangelical. Africa, it's Islamic and Christian. China, it's Christian. South Asia, it's all kinds of things. So there's that, and then even in the West itself, the sort of, even in the most secularized portions, even in Northern Europe, the sort of ghostly elements of religion are still there, and people are not fully, even the most secular people are very rarely fully secularized.
Thank you. You mentioned China, and a sociologist who's Chinese-American named Fengang Yang has argued that universities need to undergo a paradigm shift, much like a scientific revolution, in light of the strong empirical evidence that the world is not becoming more secular. Do you agree? And if so, what should that paradigm shift look like?
I mean, paradigm shift, as we've been told, is a very strong, megalomaniacal sounding term. So maybe I won't use the term paradigm shift. But I would say that the modern university could do a better job of you know, approaching and understanding religion, then it, you know, the modern university is deeply shaped by assumptions that are fundamentally connected to the secularization thesis, right? And, you know, this goes back to 19th century revolutions in the nature of the university, how people conceived of the mission of the university. It's connected to sort of John Deweyan theories of education and democracy and so on, all of which I think are just connected to a pinched and narrow view of what the modern future and the human future is likely to bring. And that doesn't mean that, you know, once Protestant, now secular universities like this one need to become Protestant again. Maybe some of them should, but, you know, it does mean that essentially, at the very least, the great universities of the West could stand to spend a little more time thinking about how their official commitment to diversity of thought, to intellectual pluralism, and so on, could make room for more voices that not only are interested in and understand religion, but try to understand it from the inside, which is to say, are religious themselves. And so it's, I don't know if it's a paradigm shift, but I think, you know, Harvard University would be a better version, even on its own terms, of its own self, if it had more Catholics, Protestants, Orthodox Jews, Muslims, and so on the faculty who were practicing believers. You know, and there are supply and demand issues here, obviously, with academic talent, and there's an endless and circular debate about whether the fact that the university is secular discourages religious academics from pursuing academic careers, or whether the university is secular because religious people don't go into academia and so on. And, you know, those are all, again, issues that would take much too long to unpack, and probably Peter has more interesting thoughts than I do. But at the very least, I think that the commitment that schools like Harvard make to the pursuit of racial, ethnic, and socioeconomic diversity could stand to be augmented by a focus on an intellectual diversity that makes more room for both serious study of religion, but also serious study of religion that takes the possibility that religious views are true seriously.
Peter has made the case that unlike in traditional societies where religious worldviews are taken for granted, modernization causes people, as he said, to rub shoulders daily with people whose religious views differ radically. This can cause people to respond more conservatively as they look for certainty in fundamentalism. Alternatively, people may relativize their beliefs. So Christianity may be true for you, while Hinduism is true for me. Ross, in America today, is this sense that all religions are equally valid a commonly held belief, especially among those in their teens and 20s?
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, yes, absolutely. And I think the way Peter framed it, just the idea that, you know, the more you have contact with diversity, the harder it becomes to believe that your particular truth, your particular church has a monopoly on the truth. That's a deep and important insight. And it's connected, you know, it's connected to sort of the immediate pluralism of people having friends and neighbors of different religious persuasions, but it's also just connected to communications technology, television, the internet, globalization, and so on. The fact that we have semi-immediate access to, you know, life in Southeast Asia, life in Africa, life in Russia, and so on, that all these aspects of sort of the global human family are available to us virtually at any time, I think just makes it very hard to sit down and think, okay, but my first Presbyterian church that my parents took me to, you know, on the town green is the one true church, right? That just becomes a lot harder. And, you know, you see this in endless versions of public opinion data, but, you know, they had the famous Middletown study, which Muncie, Indiana, I think, where they, you know, they went and sort of looked at what was supposedly a representative American community. And I think there was a version in the 30s or 40s and a version in the 70s or 80s. And the question was, do you think Christianity is the one true religion and everyone should be converted to it? And there weren't big differences in terms of religious practice between those two eras, but there were huge differences between the first question and between the first era and the second. Over that 40-year period, this sort of middle American community just became less likely to say, yes, Christianity is the one true faith and everyone should be converted to it. And that has big implications, right? And it's why there's the big trend, at least as I see it, in American religion over the last 50 or 60 years has not been towards unbelief, sort of deep skepticism, not towards Richard Dawkins style, slam the book down, that's it for God, but it has been towards a sort of relativistic view of faith that is also then of necessity a kind of partially deinstitutionalized form of faith. Because no matter what, if you don't have that assumption that your institution is the institution, your bond to it is going to be weaker. And then beyond that, it ends up seeming to many people, we are a consumer society after all, that it's not just that you should, you know, church shop, it's that you can create your own religion, right? You can take a little bit of Buddhism, a pinch of Hinduism, some of your Christian background, and some Zen aphorisms and so on, and you can do yoga and recite the Serenity Prayer and so on, and you will have your own religion that works for you. This is why I tend to think Eat, Pray, Love, Elizabeth Gilbert's best-selling book, is sort of an incredibly representative religious text for our age. It's a very sincere portrait of an intense religious quest that does not end with conversion. It doesn't end with her saying, well, I found God in India, therefore I should become a Hindu. Or I found God in India, but this has confirmed me in my childhood Christian faith. It just ends in a sort of open-ended way where she's had encounters with the divine and that shapes her life, but she's not submitting to any pre-existing tradition. And so I think that's one of the big, you know, when we talk about, we can talk about it as secularization, we can talk about it as pluralism, but that sort of individualism, deinstitutionalization, and so on is a big and inevitable part of this story, at least for now.
Okay, what you describe is a lot of data, there's some wonderful data, but American data, great.
We're good at data.
Yeah, American sociologists can be pretty good with data. But pluralism doesn't mean, relativization doesn't mean relativism. Relativization means I'm not as sure as my grandparents were. But I still, it doesn't mean everything is the same. All religions can't be true. They contradict on many points. And if you're a person of faith, of whatever faith, you are putting your bet on a particular form of faith. You say, I'm a Christian, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Buddhist, which means there are, all the other ones are less true. So relativism is when you say all religions are the same. They are not all the same. And if you have faith, you have a particular faith. At least most people do. Some will well describe, as you just did, a little bit from India, a little bit from my Catholic grandmother, etc. But most of it I put like a Lego game, I put together. That's a very significant group of people. But come with me to Central Texas, where I spent a lot of time recently, and many people are not like that at all. They are evangelical Christians. They may be more tolerant than their grandparents were. They are, but most of them are. But they affirm something. I think that's important. And in terms of America, I think it's very interesting. I mentioned Central Texas, but it's not just Central Texas. It's the Sun Belt overlaps with the Bible Belt. That's very interesting. And the Sun Belt is one of the economically most dynamic, if you like, most modern parts of the country. Enormously vital economically, rationally. And yet, the fortress of evangelical Protestantism still today. That's very significant. And that's why I said for most religious people of whatever tradition, religion and secularity are not a question of either or, a question of both and. And what both and means has to be negotiated by individuals and by religious communities.
Peter, you've described modernization as a movement from fate to choice, where people are no longer just continuing beliefs of the community into which they were born without ever having to question. Instead, they're becoming more conscious of the need to choose.
Conscious of what?
The need to choose what to believe. What does this mean for a person living in America today, particularly those in their early 20s?
Well, I don't know that the early 20s are a particularly privileged population. I mean, everyone in America, unless you live in a kind of sectarian subworld, is confronted with pluralism every day and has to come to terms with it. I mean, you get in interview situations, wonderful interviews about everyday religion. Someone says, well, I happen to be Catholic, a wonderful phrase, I happen to be. Interesting. I hurt my foot, I happen to be Catholic. My grandmother still goes to Mass every morning. I don't. I'm not sure what I believe. My wife is Protestant. My daughter is dating a Jewish boy. And my son is into Buddhism. This is not unusual. And people have to come to terms with this in their own lives. That doesn't mean that the guy who says, I guess it was the man who said it in my example, could be the woman, said, I happen to be Catholic, that there's no faith there anymore. But it's not as, there is some doubt surrounding it. And I think that's a good thing. And if you value freedom, which I think we should, it's important that religion is a free choice, a free act, ongoing free act, and there's not a condition like your hair color or your particular allergy. It's not like that. It's something you have to affirm, you have to have faith in.
Well, let me, I think that's a very, if I may, Protestant perspective. And what I think one difficulty is that when applied to Catholicism, I was interested in your comment about how successfully Catholicism had adapted to this landscape of pluralism. Because from speaking, I'm Roman Catholic, and speaking at least somewhat from the inside of that tradition, it seems more like Catholicism has been stuck in a 40 or 50 year period of conflict, agony, and civil war as it tries to figure out whether it can adapt to that landscape and still remain the kind of religion that it was prior to Vatican II. And I think the answer is actually quite unclear. I think that there is the person who says, I happen to be Catholic, right? I agree with you that that person is not a secularized, not a secular person. They're not an atheist. They're some kind of religious believer. They have spiritual interests. They have a prayer life. They may believe, they believe in an afterlife. They recite the Hail Mary. They go to Mass sometimes and so on. But at the same time, that person doesn't go to Mass as often as their parents did or their grandparents did. Among white Catholics in the United States, Mass attendance has been going steadily downward since the 1960s. The sort of resilience of Catholicism in the US is mostly due to Hispanic immigration. And it's very unclear whether, you know, whether that person's child will identify as Catholic at all. Many of the people who we call the nuns, the people with no religious affiliation, many of them are ex-Catholics or the children of ex-Catholics. Ex-Catholics are one of the largest religious groups, so to speak, in the United States right now. And at that point, those people are, they're still drawing something from Catholicism. It's still part of the vocabulary of whatever their own religious beliefs are, but Catholicism isn't drawing anything from them anymore because they're not going to church, they're not at Mass, they're not part of the religious community. And Catholicism is a religion that, in its self-understanding, depends on community, continuity, tradition, and so on. So I think that that's, I'm just sort of, I'm skeptical of how I'm very persuaded that even in the most modern parts of the world, religious belief, spiritual interest, and so on is going to persist indefinitely into the future, just because human beings keep having religious experiences, right? But that, I mean, that alone, I think, guarantees religion's persistence. But I think it's an open question how particular institutional manifestations of Christianity or any other religion endure. And one of the interesting things about our era is that in certain ways, you know, some of the most resilient communities are the communities that still have this sort of pre-pluralist intensity. The Mormons, you know, among the Jewish groups you mentioned, it's the Orthodox who are growing fastest. Within Catholicism, it's some of the more traditional elements that that have been, in certain ways, most resilient demographically and so on. And once you sort of, that resilience is a sort of sealed off resilience, right? Mormonism can be resilient because it is geographically concentrated in Utah and has built sort of a world unto itself. And the more it expands beyond Utah, the more it enters the pluralist landscape you're talking about, the harder it becomes to sustain. But at the same time, the attempted adaptations of institutional religions to this landscape have had real difficulties. And post-Vatican II Catholicism has had real institutional difficulties going on a very long time. And it's not clear how, you know, there's stuff going on in Rome right now that's very open-ended and uncertain. And it's not clear how it's going to be resolved. So I just have some, I suppose, Catholic doubts about the communal and institutional elements of religion in this new landscape.
Yeah, but you know, I'm not a Catholic. I've never been tempted to saying.
I'm not trying to tempt you by telling you how we're in disarray.
No, I've never been tempted to swim in the Tiber, but that's the name for conversion. Many of my friends have become Catholic. I have enormous admiration for the Catholic Church, but I must say I have great confidence in the core of that faith reasserting itself, and that's what's going on right now. I mean, whether every step, it's not quite clear just where Pope Francis is going, a general notion of where he's going. I don't think it will become like Presbyterianism. It will still be recognizably Catholic, but it has already changed, say, between the two Vatican councils, and it will continue to change. But I think there is a core which will remain, as it does with other religious traditions.
But not perhaps Episcopalianism. Right. I mean, it is possible you can see in, sorry, I know we're, I'll leave it there. With a dig at Episcopalianism, that's a good place to.
Now it's time to hear from you in the audience. I understand a number of questions have been texted in, and the team has filtered through those questions and selected ones that were particularly interesting or perhaps representative of others. So can we have our first question read out loud, please?
Hi, and thank you for your insights. The first question is, if the world is becoming more religious or pluralist, why is the intelligentsia more secular? What are they missing?
So can you say it one more time, please?
I can say it. The question is, if the world is, as we're both, I guess, asserting, in certain ways, growing more religious, why is the intelligentsia still so secular? What are they missing?
You describe beautifully what they are missing. They're missing 90% of the news. But why is there an international intelligentsia? It happens to be mostly in the humanities and social sciences. Physicists, for example, tend to be quite different. The universe is so mysterious, it's very difficult to be a real secularist ideology when you're dealing with the galaxies, it seems. But it has become a culture which goes right back to the Enlightenment. It's an elite culture. The Enlightenment created an elite which believed itself to be free of all superstitions, free especially of the superstitions of Christianity, and they were the future, the enlightened future. Well, the future didn't turn out to be all that enlightened. So this faith in pure reason and enlightenment has gotten through some severe shocks, which is healthy. Doesn't mean we should try to get rid of everything the Enlightenment created, not at all. But people should have doubts. Speaking in Cambridge, Massachusetts, there's that wonderful book, I forget the name of the author, about this group of philosophers at Harvard around William James. what was it called, the Metaphysics Club, something like that. And there was the one guy who, Oliver Wendell Holmes, who went into the Civil War as an officer in the Union Army, and he was so appalled by the cruelty on both sides and the absolute convictions that people had, where he came back and showed in his, when he became a justice of the Supreme Court, he had a terrible suspicion of all certainties. Certainty kills. And it doesn't mean you can't believe in anything. That means always have a little bit of doubt. It's healthy. Don't be absolutely sure. Have faith, but don't be sure. Don't think you're certain. I resonate with that.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I'm always a little bit surprised at the sort of persistence of secularism among, I guess I can say, since we're in Harvard University, our fellow elites, just because it strikes me as, well, in particular, the marriage of sort of a benevolent, liberal, human rights-based universalism with a godless, essentially meaningless cosmos seems to me a combination that, you know, is possible to sustain, obviously, but suggests some real tensions, right, between, you know, and those tensions, I think, were brought out in many ways in the late 19th and early 20th century in sort of ultimately fairly horrifying ways in Western Europe. But since then, it feels like people have sort of said, well, you know, we saw where sort of total de-Christianization could go in certain ways in Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union, so we don't want to go that far. But we're going to keep our sort of, you know, not atheistic, but pretty agnostic view of the world, but we're also going to hold on to a sort of Christian-ish religion-influenced view of human dignity and human rights. And we've sort of stayed there for a while. And yeah, I'm sort of surprised at that. I'm surprised that there aren't that many sort of new religion-inflected, religion-influenced movements within the intelligentsia. And I guess I'm not surprised that traditional Christianity or traditional Western monotheism is particularly unpopular with the intelligentsia right now, because the message of the New Testament on not only issues of sort of wealth and power, but since the sexual revolution, especially issues of sexual morality, cuts very strongly against the kind of, you know, it cuts against the modern lifestyle in many different ways, but it cuts particularly strongly against the lifestyle and freedoms that our sort of globalized elite takes for granted as their birthright. And so I'm not surprised that there's sort of this default assumption at places like Harvard and elsewhere that, you know, traditional religion is backward because it doesn't want you to, you know, have as much fun, basically, as a truly liberated person should be having. But I am surprised that there aren't more, for instance, deists and pantheists in the secular elite. And there sort of are. I mean, I think if you scratch the surface of some allegedly secular people, they would be functionally pantheist or something. But they would say, you know, there's some sort of purpose or meaning in the universe, even if I don't understand it. But I'm just surprised that hasn't taken on a fuller form, that there isn't more intellectual interest in it. I don't know if any of you guys followed the controversy around this book Thomas Nagel, the philosopher at Columbia, wrote called Mind and Cosmos, that was sort of a critique of the sort of materialist paradigm in philosophy and science. And, you know, I'm a Catholic Christian, I'm obviously biased, but I thought it was a, you know, had some problems and issues, but it seemed like a pretty compelling critique, and not a critique, you know, Nagel's not a Christian, it's not a critique that requires that you put it down and take up any kind of traditional religion, but it's a critique that I think would naturally point well-educated people towards some sort of slightly different conception of the universe. But I, you know, we haven't gotten there yet, and it's sort of an interesting question how long this sort of post-Second World War kind of dynamic of, you know, alleged materialist cosmos over here and human rights and human dignity over there can keep moving. I don't know.
But, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if this would change. This might change. And one thing, I mean, it's not an accident. You mentioned sexual morality. Much of the hostility to religion, often hostility or not superstition, it's bad, we have to get beyond it, has to do with a very simple fact. Fornication becomes a very pleasant habit. And if people feel that that habit is being threatened, they get upset. And I think you see this in the data all the time. Why are young people against religion? Because it stops some of their most pleasurable activities. This relationship, well, I've had a lot to do with evangelicals in recent years because I've been teaching part-time in Texas, and I kept saying to people, let's talk of something else. God isn't all that interested in your genitalia. And if people focus on that, yes, it will make them suspicious of religious strictures.
I actually think God, well, anyway.
You think God is interested?
I know we need to get to another question, but I think there are very good reasons why most religious traditions have spent a fair amount of time and sort of energy thinking about moral systems around sexuality. I think, you know, because it's the locus of the begetting of the future of the human race and the locus of family relationships and community relationships and kinship and so on. I don't think you can have an effective religious system without it doesn't have to be, you know, New Testament sexual ethics, but you have to have, I guess my conception of God wouldn't make sense if he didn't care about who we were having sex with.
I think we have time for one more question.
If someone believes their faith to be true and life-changing, how does someone respect and embrace pluralism and yet evangelize their own beliefs?
Could you hear that?
If somebody believes their own faith to be true, to be true in the deepest sense, I assume, how can they both respect pluralism and live in a pluralist society, but also follow through and evangelize as they feel their faith calls them to do?
Well, I mean, if by evangelism you mean trying to convert somebody to your own religious position, I don't think it's a necessary consequence of having faith. I mean, the only people I want to convert, if at all possible, is people whom I fundamentally disagree on certain moral issues. But somebody who is not a Christian, I don't believe he or she goes to hell because they don't pray to Jesus Christ. I mean, I don't think, in other words, the alternative is not a sort of anything goes kind of religion to a very rigid dogma. And I think, again, if you take the Catholic case, the declaration on religious freedom in the Second Vatican Council is a wonderful foundation for freedom. It's part of human dignity. And human dignity is crucial, it seems to me, to a Christian ethic. And human dignity can take different forms. Look, I've been married for many years, and I think monogamy is a pretty good arrangement, but I wouldn't make it a kind of absolute dogmatic necessity.
I guess I think the tension that the questioner suggests is a little stronger than that. I mean, I think that I guess I'd put it this way, in the day-to-day of a pluralist society, I don't think there needs to be any tension between saying, I respect pluralism, but I also want to, you know, change people's minds on issues where I think I'm right, right? And, you know, I mean, just as a Democrat would want a Republican to become a Democrat without wanting, you know, the two-party system to cease to exist, so too a Catholic could want their atheist friend to become a Catholic without wanting to return to sort of a pre-Vatican II conception of the Catholic Church's role in society. So in terms of sort of everyday life for a religious believer, I don't think there has to be any kind of tension. But there is another sense, sort of on a deeper long-term cultural level, where the claims that religion makes are a little more profound than the claims that the, you know, Republican National Committee makes, I hope. And over time, religions that take those claims seriously, religious believers who take those claims seriously, tend to want more than pluralism. And this can, you know, in its darkest form, this can lead to truly terrible places, like, you know, the Islamic State, right? But the Islamic State is itself partially a reaction to, I think, a feeling in Western modernity that, you know, nothing seems to matter. So you get these sort of drifting young men who, you know, again, are attracted by the ability to live out horrifying fantasies of violence, but are also attracted seemingly by the idea of a situation or a society that offers an absolute form of meaning. So that's sort of the darkest portrayal of where that tendency in religion goes. But just to use your example of, you know, that I think I've heard Christians cite a lot in this context, that we've sort of returned to a period like the Roman Empire, right, where Christianity is one faith among many, and that, you know, that offers all kinds of opportunities that were available to the early Christians, and they made the most of them, and so on. But the story that Christians tell about the early Roman Empire is a story of conversion. It's not a story of pluralism as a permanent state of affairs. It's a story of the blood of the martyrs as the seed of a church that went on to build Christendom. And I don't know if that idea, I mean, maybe that idea disappears with pluralism, but I think it's an idea that is inherent in a lot of serious religious faith, and not just Christianity. It's inherent in Islam. Any kind of faith that's rooted in a missionary impulse is going to want a conversion of culture in the long run. So again, in the society we're living in right now, you know, that's a long-term issue, and, you know, I spend a lot of time reassuring my liberal friends that, you know, Christian fundamentalism isn't a threat to the American order and so on. So I don't want to push this point too far, because then they'll throw it back in my face and say, see, it is a threat. But I do think that there are sort of tensions there between what pluralism asks of us and what a lot of Christians going back to the earliest centuries of the faith have thought that the New Testament asks of them, which is to go and make disciples of all nations, and which would mean making disciples of as many people as possible within this nation, which would have inevitably transformative effects that would transform pluralism as well.
I don't think if we had more time, we'd disagree very much.
Probably not.
I mean, I can agree with much of what you say, maybe not some of the details, but I think a strong affirmation of faith in no way means a contradiction to pluralism. On the contrary, it flourishes under pluralism.
I hate to end here. I think we could go on for another hour or two. But I'm going to hand the floor back to our MC, Diane Kim. And before we do that, let's thank our presenters, please.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.